The U.S. surgical workforce has actually increased a significant amount in the 25 years recently studied. And that workforce actually increased in excess of the increase in the population in the U.S. So you might say, well, we got plenty of surgeons. And in fact, per capita, if that's the only statistic you look at, there are more surgeons per capita in the United States now than there used to be. But this really ignores a bunch of trends that we're all aware of. First of all, the huge, huge increase in the number of subspecialists. Declining work effort, that doesn't mean that we work less hard. It's just different. It's we apply our hours differently. We have to actually, I think that practice has become less efficient. And there's a huge geographic maldistribution in the United States that we're going to really focus on today. The work effort is that we have an aging physician population. The increasing number of female physicians is a huge positive, but FTE of one is not quite as high in that group during the child rearing years, and it's not as high actually in younger physicians overall. And I'm here to tell you, I think that's probably a good thing. The old days of a surgeon practicing an FTE of 2.0 wasn't particularly healthy. And not great for families and for the rest of one's life. So, but that's change. And what it means is we need more people to cover the same amount of work. Physician employees tend to not work necessarily as hard or see the same volume as those that were in practice on their own. And we see a huge increase in the number of physician employees. And physicians don't work until they have one foot in the grave anymore. Again, a very positive change, but something you have to be aware of when you're looking at the workforce. So back to those trends, if you consider what we just talked about as sort of the other things beyond just surgeons per capita, only 4% of the net gain in surgical workforce during those 25 years recently studied were general surgeons. And if the population went up by 31%, it's not hard to figure out that the general surgeons decreased as a proportion of the total surgical workforce. And this is the percent decrease, 24% to 18%. So more surgeons overall, but a lot more specialists, a lot less who classified themselves as general surgeons or had a practice that was general surgery. And in fact, the number of general surgeons in the United States has decreased. Maybe this is just a classification thing, but if you actually look at the work being done, it is a decrease. So the general surgeon to population ratio, as opposed to the surgeon to population ratio, has diminished. And this has been most recently felt the strongest in urban areas. But if you look in rural areas, the general surgeon to population ratio is the lowest in the United States. So again, getting to the maldistribution, and excuse my one typographical error there, but general surgeon to population ratio actually decreased in 41% of U.S. counties during the 25 years that this workforce study was completed in the United States. Southern and Midwestern states, where we live, most affected. 925 counties in the United States had no surgeon of any kind in 2006. This is a collective population of 14 million people. Now, half of those counties don't have hospitals. And so they're not going to probably have a surgeon. But half of those counties do have hospitals, hospitals that may depend on surgeons and don't have one. Looking for one, maybe looking for two. So this highlights what the problem is in our country. I'm a huge map person. This speaks volumes. So this is a map of the United States, which by county shows the number of surgeons per 1,000 population. This is in the year 2009, the most recent statistics we have. The counties that are in white have no surgeons. And look where that is. It's, well, Wisconsin has a few. But it's across the middle part of the United States, southern states, and western states, rural part of the United States. Same map that plots general surgeons per 100,000 population per county. And again, the white counties have no general surgeons, and that's 1,183 counties in the United States. No general surgeon. General surgeons are essential for these small hospitals to keep alive. And we don't have really good numbers on what the value of a general surgeon is. They know what they can bill, but we don't know exactly how much money they generate for a hospital. But it has been estimated that it's over $2 million per year for a small hospital. That's huge. That's a big, big part of their budget, the biggest part of their budget. So that's the value of a general surgeon to a small hospital. So the impending crisis we have is obvious. We have 1,183 counties in the United States without a general surgeon. Over half of those have hospitals. And without a general surgeon, many of these hospitals will either have to close, have been closing, or will have to curtail or have been curtailing a lot of their services. Rural Americans, what does that mean for them? It means that they have to travel long distances for care. And if you know anything about people who live in rural areas, they don't like to come to big cities. They find La Crosse, Wisconsin confusing. They find Madison even more so and Milwaukee worse. So what that means is long distance to care, it's inconvenient, their families can't be with them, and that translates into they may not get care, or they may just decide to get care in a delayed fashion. And that actually has been shown that there is a delay in diagnosis for rural Americans. I like trauma. I enjoy taking trauma calls still, which is shows some of the sickness I still have. But I want to just use trauma as an example of what might happen. So right now, rural general surgeons are an integral part of our statewide trauma systems. And in Wisconsin, it's an inclusive system. We have only three level ones, and we have less than 10 level twos in the state. Most of our hospitals are level three and level four institutions. And the rural surgeons are the providers that run the trauma care in these small rural hospitals. They're the first people who see the trauma patient. So this is obviously very true in these large rural states in which we live and west of here. And if you look at this, is another one of these map things that I love. And all I want to show you is wherever there's a blue, light blue dot, the bigger the dot is means there are more surgeons in that particular area. So a small dot means there are a few surgeons. Big dot means there are a lot of surgeons. And the age-adjusted death rates per 100,000 people in the population due to motor vehicle, unintentional traumatic injuries, the death rate is marked on this map in shades of tan. The highest death rate is where you have the brown counties. So it's all by county again. And the lowest death rate is where you have the light tan or white counties. And you can see where you have a lot of surgeons, a lot of resources, the death rate from trauma is much lower. And where you don't have resources, you don't have a lot of surgeons, you have a much, much higher death rate due to trauma. This shows the effect of sophisticated surgical care in the treatment of trauma patients. So what will be the effect of losing more and more general surgeons from rural counties or not replacing the ones that we have? What's going to happen is we'll have delayed resuscitation, delayed stabilization for our rural trauma patients. There'll be much less effective trauma care coordination in these small towns, these small hospitals. Much less effective trauma triage. And what will have to happen is you'll have to transport untriaged, unworked up, unstabilized patients to the remaining trauma centers, which may be just the ones and twos. We will flood our ones and twos. And we'll flood them with people that don't need to be there. So this has an effect not just in rural areas. This will affect the statewide trauma system. It'll affect the big trauma centers as well as the small ones. And the long-term effects will be that these small rural hospitals will have to give up services and will close. And that will further exacerbate the problem in trauma care. So statewide trauma systems will have to change. You may have PAs and NPs or family docs doing your initial triage. Or you may have to change your transportation system to get all these patients who are poorly worked up to the main trauma centers, and then you'll have to change your workforce there. So huge ramifications if we lose our rural general surgeon just in that one area, managing trauma. So what's the forecast for the surgical workforce? We talked about the figures we have up to date. The forecast is that there'll be an 18% decrease in surgeon supply from 2009 to 2028. Only in these specialties listed up here is it likely we're going to have stable numbers or increased numbers of people. And there are no current graduate medical education strategies that are sufficient to offset the declines that we're going to see in general surgery. So there is concern. There's concern now, and I think our concern is likely to be multiplied. So how do you define rural and urban? Everybody's got a different idea. So I gave one talk on rural general surgery at the Western Surgical Association. They got up and made a comment, and honestly, their comment gave the idea that Denver was rural. So we've got to be very careful about our definitions. So the definition that's most accepted is that urban is greater by 32 people, I think, is considered urban. Large rural, 10 to 50,000. Small rural, 2,500 to 10,000. And isolated or austere, less than 2,500 in the community. What do we know about the general surgery job market? And we know this from your work and your outcomes research from the Department of Surgery at UW. And that is, if you look at all the available positions in two states, Oregon and Wisconsin, that were studied from 2011 to 2012, looking at all job postings, hospital, private practice groups, physician recruiters, getting all this information together, we know that there were about 71 general surgery positions in these two states, and nearly half of those positions were for rural locations. Most of these positions, there was no requirement for fellowship training and actually not really a desire for fellowship-trained surgeons. What they did want is they wanted somebody with experience in OBGYN to provide surgical obstetric coverage, and they wanted somebody with a lot of endoscopic experience. But the mismatch is that the graduates of the programs in Oregon and Wisconsin, most of them did take fellowships, which is the national trend. It's not different from any place else. In fact, the number in Oregon, Wisconsin is slightly lower than the national number, which is closer to 80%. So fellowship training is common in these two states where the jobs are asking for not fellowship-trained people. And so fellowship training was required or preferred for only 18% of those positions that were classified as rural general surgery positions. 28% of those who were urban general surgery positions. The academic positions, of course, did require or prefer fellowship training. So again, most of the open positions were in rural general surgery, urban general surgery, if you look at the bottom line. So now I want to switch gears. Who goes into the practice of rural general surgery today? And that's a study that that we did with folks here in Madison, Milwaukee, and in Marshfield. And we did this by surveying recent graduates of the four training programs in surgery in the years leading up to 2008, the study published in 2009. And this shouldn't surprise you. People that want to go into rural general surgery have rural backgrounds. They either went to high school or college in a rural area. Very important, actually, is their spouse was from a rural area. And this also isn't a huge surprise, but most of those folks had done a rural clerkship in medical school And it had some experience in a residency that offered a rural rotation, either by elective or mandatory rotation. So it's basically somebody is from a rural area and goes to a program or a medical school where they continue to get some of that experience, or they might have come from an urban area and been exposed to a rural experience during medical school or residency. So right now, just some of our area medical schools, there are a lot of them that offer rural tracks. Probably the longest standing one in this area is actually in Minnesota, their RPAP program. You cannot believe the number of rural general surgeons that have been generated out of that program. Most of those folks, they go to a rural rotation to work with a family practice doc, and they just run into one or two of the general surgeons. They get turned on by it. That is their introduction to general surgery, and they go from there. The program here in Madison started a number of years ago, and outstanding, the WARM program. I think it is going to generate a lot of folks that will go into practice in rural areas. The question is how many will actually pick surgery. And as far as residency experiences, this is really an area that I'm excited about because it's growing. And your institution is an example of this, that there are at least a few programs now around the United States who are starting to offer rural experiences during the residency training, either as a year or a couple of months during training. And this is just an example of some of the programs that were out there when I made up this slide about 6 months ago. And then finally, difference between rural and urban surgeons. Rural surgeons are older, more male, and more likely to have gone to a foreign medical school. These are probably older statistics. Things are changing, and I'll show you an example of how that's changing over time. So what are the challenges of rural surgery? Well, obvious, professional isolation. It's hard to acquire new skills if you didn't have them when you arrived there, and surgery is changing so fast, you really want to be in a position where you can learn new skills. Call coverage, that's actually should be the first on the list. That's the biggest challenge for a rural general surgeon, trying to avoid being on call 365. That's one of the biggest problems. Reimbursement, they don't get paid as much in general. And because of the Medicare geographic distribution problems, they work in the areas of the country where the their productivity is the least. They get paid less for doing the same things that people do in urban areas. Administrative duties are overwhelming for all of us. The difference is they have no help. It's hard to get your CME when you're on 365 days a year. If you're interested in doing education and research, good luck. Probably went to the wrong place. And you are the victim of volume as a surrogate for quality initiatives that we write about in the big medical centers every day. We write about, oh, yeah, you just have to do the most. If you do the most, you get the best outcomes. And so that's true of everything, basically. It's true of breast surgery, hernia surgery, colon, esophagus, stomach. And those are great studies. And they may be statistically meaningful. But every one of those studies that comes out hurts a general surgeon who says, well, God, I'm not able to really do anything at the same quality, it seems. And so well-intended studies have consequences for other providers. So who is the rural surgeon? They're obviously the abdominal surgeon. They're the endoscopist. They're the critical care doc for their hospital. They do nutrition. Nobody else will do it. They're the surgical obstetrician. They're the trauma surgeon. They're the subspecialty surgeon. They are a general surgeon. We looked at what our regional surgeons do in their practices, and these are the numbers. This is what it is. The number one procedure for them is endoscopy. The number two procedure in our system, the Gunderson system, are GYN cases. And then it goes down from there. If you add it all up, they still do a lot of general surgery. But they do a lot of ones and fives and tens. They don't do 100 of anything in their practice. If you look at A study done in North Dakota of all procedures, outpatient and inpatient, done by general surgeons in the entire state, well, it's both North Dakota and South Dakota. I realize they're no longer a territory. So they did two states. But same things. Look at how many cases these folks did in a year. Over 1,000 cases a year. These are the rural surgeons, and which are most of the surgeons in the Dakota Territory. Almost 40% of their cases endoscopy, only about 25% classic general surgery, and then 18% minor surgery, and as many as 12% of their cases are what we would consider surgical subspecialty cases, urology, orthopedics, hand, OBGYN, and such things. And another study done at the American Board of Surgery looking at volumes that were reported when folks took their research exam, and then correlating that by zip code, you can see that rural surgeons do a lot of surgery. They do a lot of cases. There may be a lot of small cases, a lot of endoscopic cases, but a lot of cases. So how do you train people for that particular skill set? How do you actually train people? And this is something we've had a terrific interest in La Crosse. It's been our niche interest since we started our program, and continues to be. And this is sort of what it is: a strong core knowledge in all of the basic areas of general surgery, absolutely key. You can see they have to perform all those duties, they need to know about them. There's some unique additional skill sets we'll talk about. They have to have broad-based medical skills, because they're gonna do their own pre-op evaluation, they do all their own post-op care, they do all the critical care in their hospital. They need to know how to take medicine. So they need some practice management skills. That's actually what scares our graduates the most coming out of our program. It's not doing surgery. It's not taking care of patients. It's, am I going to make a mess of myself financially? I don't know how to code. I don't know how to reimburse. I don't know how to deal with insurance companies. We need to give our graduates those kinds of skill sets. And we need to give them a way to, an easy way to continue to keep up with the knowledge that continues to expand at an exponential rate. So I'm going to talk about our system now. I'm not saying our system is without problems. We got lots of problems in our system. Every system does. But I want to talk about our system as an example of a program that seems to prepare people well for rural general surgery. And it's a system I know well, so excuse me for kind of leaning on it to make a few points. But our system, I was doctor number 145 in 1982. Our system now has 500 physicians, over 6,000 employees, so it's a big system. We just built a new hospital, which is awesome, except it's so big that nobody knows how to get from one room to the next for us. That sounds ridiculous, but it's true. We have 17 general surgeons at our main clinic, so La Crosse population approximately 51,000. We have 25 branch clinics in our system, and we have 11 general surgeons who practice outside of the main hospital. They practice, their main hospital is not in La Crosse. It's at one of the regional sites. These are where all of our branch clinics are. We're not going through that. Our residency started in 1974. We started with one categorical position a year, and we've grown to the huge size of three categorical positions per year. It's the only surgical residency in La Crosse, so there's no OBGYN, no urology, no neurosurgery. It's the only residency in any surgical area. We have one fellowship. It's a bariatric MIS fellowship, one person per year. Transition to practice associate. That's some people consider a fellowship, but it's a person who comes after training, before they go into practice, and they sort of transition from being a fellow to a junior partner during the course of 1 year. So that tells you what our educational sort of environment is in La Crosse. Our general surgery residency is committed to general surgery. So on day one, we're trying to prepare people to be ready at the end of 5 years for a practice in general surgery. If they happen to pick up a subspecialty interest along the way, or they knew that they wanted one when they started, absolutely, we will prepare them for that as well. But our goal on day one is to have them done by the end of the fifth year. We have a high volume still of open cases, although that's shrinking like everybody else, as it should. because MIS has better solutions for some of the stuff that we used open surgery for. We have a high volume laparoscopic program, both basic and complex for our residents. Our residents do 2 months of critical care in the R1 and R3 years. They're the trauma resuscitation leaders through their R4 and R5 5 years. They do 2 months of OBGYN. That's required of all of our residents. High volume endoscopy, what does that mean? 150 uppers, 150 lowers. And it's not just diagnostic. They'll do the polyp removals and whatnot as well. Those that are interested in a rural practice potentially can take up to 3 months in a rural surgery elective. And I mentioned already that we did the practice management. These are some of the elements of our practice management curriculum. Ethics, coding reimbursement, preparing for and trying to avoid malpractice situations, how to look at a contract, and basically, how do you run a clinic? How do you actually get through a clinic that has 40 patients in a day? Our rural surgery elective is at one of two sites right now in Prairie du Chien, Wisconsin, where there are three women surgeons who are just awesome, and Decorah, Iowa, where there are three male surgeons who are just awesome, and a college town. We've also allowed people to go to where they're going to practice and spend a month or two to see what skill sets they might need so they can come back in their R4 and R5 years, and actually we can give them some extra exposure to GYN or endoscopy or hand surgery if that's what they think they're going to need. And we do have international electives as part of our global program in La Crosse, Ethiopia, Tanzania, and I know this isn't outside the United States, but it might as well be out on the Pine Ridge Reservation where it's a third world experience as well. So our residents can take rotations in those areas. These are where our regional surgeons practice. So Tomah, Wisconsin, Viroqua, Wisconsin, Prairie du Chien, and then Decorah, Iowa. Black River Falls has a square because it's not one of our surgeons, but we have an educational agreement with the two surgeons in Black River Falls to provide educational experience there as well. Our emphasis in our residency is always on academics. I always have a hard time when people call residency programs community programs and academic programs because it sort of means that the community program probably isn't academic. And I think that community programs have to be just as academic as university programs. And so there needs to be that emphasis. So our residents have to publish, they have to present, and just like your M&Ms, it's evidence-based sort of material, very, very academic approach. So with all that said of what our program consists of, what do we produce out of La Crosse? And so if you look at our graduates from 83 to 2013, this is very different from probably what you see in Madison and very different from the nation as a whole. Only 30% of our graduates pursue fellowship after graduation. And there are many university programs that say, oh, man, that's a really a crappy program. I mean, man, only 30%. We get 98. To me, I'm so proud of this because I'm most proud of our graduates who are willing to take on something that I wasn't willing to take on, and that's to go practice general surgery in a rural area. I practice general surgery in a huge multi-specialty clinic. That's easy. If you look at our grads, 70% of our grads practice general surgery right out of training, and about two-thirds of those practice in an area less than 10,000. And about half of those in towns of 5,000 or less. So it just gives you a little different idea. And I think, you know, we have a different kind of program. And our residents, our applicants to our residency, when they come to us, a lot of them come to us because they know that this is the sort of training that we have a niche interest in. And so these figures shouldn't surprise me or anyone else. One of the myths is that only the worst residents go into the rural areas. Nothing could be farther from the truth, and I wanted to look at our experience to show this. And so I looked at our graduates, and I went and looked at their USMLE scores, and I categorized them by rural general surgery, urban general surgery, and those that went to fellowship. And you can see there's no statistical difference in any of these groups. They basically all had the same USMLE scores. And then I looked, how did they do on the qualifying exam? Abside performance, very important, but some people study and some people don't. Whereas for the QE, I pretty much think that everybody studies. So I looked at these numbers. And if you look at the mean score, that these are the raw scores on the qualifying exam, again, no difference between those that went into general surgery and no difference by where the practice location was. It's the same. So don't let anybody talk you into that myth. Actually, the largest number of AOAs in our program went into rural general surgery. And then the last thing about our residency I think is really important is that you have a responsibility that goes beyond graduation for the rural general surgeons. You can still be a resource for them. And so our residents, our resident graduates, they'll call the staff that they know has expertise in a certain area. They'll call a lot for the first 6 months and then a little bit the next 6 months, and then you don't hear from them very much after that. But it's important to be a resource for your graduates, especially those that are in an austere area. We have our graduates come back and participate in the CME programs as teachers, or they can come back and get CME credits in some of our programming. And probably the best example of those teaching opportunities are in our ATLS course, where at least half of our ATLS instructors are former residents, and many of them from rural environments come and teach our course. And then, of course, we have a number of our graduates who are at some of our locations practicing regional general surgery, and they are now mentors for the residents that go out and do those electives in Pere Duchene and in Decorah. So, again, these are the essentials in training. I've run through them already. I do think an immersion experience in rural surgery is important, and you are designing that here, and I applaud you for two things. One is for doing it. The second is for actually studying something, coming up with a conclusion, and then actually listening to your conclusions and doing something about it. So your outcome studies showed a need in the state, and you've responded to that need. So unusual for people to actually read their own research and do something about it. So that's kind of cool. So finally, the last part of my little talk here is going to be on rural surgery, rural general surgery practice. So why would you do it? And what are the cons? And what are some of the strategies for dealing with the cons? So this is why you do it. Because you can live in a place like this. You raise your family here. This is actually Driggs, Idaho. And my wife and I actually, this is the view from our living room. And we just built a log home there. It's a town of 1,900 people. They have a hospital. Guess what? No general surgeon. So I want somebody to come work here to take care of me and my family. It's really a nice view. So what are the joys? The joys, sense of community. You're a part of the community. Some of these rural general surgeons are on the school board. They can become a mayor. They can become whatever. You're really a part of the town. And your family's a part of the town. No better place to see continuity of care. You deliver the baby. You do their appendectomy. You take their gallbladder out. It goes right on all through life. Scope of practice, no bigger than any place else, any other type of practice. Independence, maybe too much sometimes, but you certainly are your own decision maker. You alone can upgrade care and have more of an impact there than any other place. Mary Lou Bintz, Pere Duchene, first surgeon in Pere Duchene. She single-handedly upgraded the care in that hospital to the level it is now, which is pretty impressive if you ever go down there. She started the ICU, and she started by doing critical care procedures, not just on surgery patients, but in MI patients admitted. She'd do all the lines. She'd help them with drips. She'd do the nutrition. You upgrade care of an entire facility when you're a rural general surgeon. Rural life and activities, if you like that stuff, obviously that's the place to do it, and great place to raise a family. But these are the challenges. We've been through this list before. You've seen it before. And now I'm going to go through, how do you deal with these? How do you deal with these challenges? So again, I go back to what I know best. Our system's not perfect, but we've done this for a bunch of decades. And we've found some things that don't work and some things that do work. And this is sort of a boiling down of what does work. So again, I told you what our clinic is made up of, 18 general surgeons in the main facility, 11 out in the region. So our regional surgeons, these are where they live and work. We have one in Tomah, Wisconsin. We're actually recruiting for a second. That's our biggest town, 9,000 people. Viroqua has 3 surgeons. Prairie du Chien has 3 surgeons. Decorah has 3 surgeons. You can see the populations of them. And then we have this sort of practice education agreement with the 2 surgeons in Black River Falls. And we help them recruit into Black River. So they're not part of our system economically, but they're a part of our system in other ways. We're integrated in other ways with them. And again, these are the locations. We acquired these practices in different ways. So in Tomah, we picked up an existing practice. But in Sparta, Whitehall, Viroqua, Prairie du Chien, those are practices that we started in these towns. Decorah, Iowa, that was another acquisition. And in Black River, we did a cooperative hiring with the Crone Clinic. So we've had to do it in different ways. You have to, there's no one way to make this happen. This is, you got to be a utility fielder here. Those regional surgeons practice in those towns. That's their main hospital. But in order to be busy enough to have 3 surgeons in Prairie du Chien or in Viroqua or in Decorah, they also provide service. They have their own outreach surgery network. And so these are the hospitals that they do outreach in: Hillsboro, Boscobel, Guttenberg, Cresco, Alcater, and West Union. And you can see these are smaller towns, but they all have hospitals that are struggling. They all these towns want surgeons. And it's actually in our best interest not to have them hire a surgeon into those small towns and funnel business away from the little pods we've developed. It's much better for us to give them service from the regional pods that we have. And so now you can see this map. The stars are where the regional surgeons practice primarily and live. And the asterisk in each case is one of the locations where they do their outreach. And you can see they're color-coded. So the pods are geographically close. They do outreach to hospitals that are close to them. So what are the elements of a system? So we really feel that we've got a rural surgery system that's based in La Crosse, at least administratively, but the work is done in our region. The foundations are, you better pick your towns right. We talked about that last night with Dr. Kent. I mean, you have to pick a town that has enough of a population and enough of a volume that you can keep surgeons busy. There have to be some primary care providers in order to take care of patients, work patients up, and refer patients. And if there's a lot of competition, it may not work. So if you have 2 or 3 health systems trying to establish general surgery in one town, that's going to be a difficult endeavor unless you cooperate. And that's unlikely these days. The regional hospital has to commit to resources to support the regional surgeon and needs to be willing to collaborate and not compete with the physician side of the practice. Big principles. We saw that this is the case mix. Call coverage. Those of us in La Crosse can't cover the regional surgeons. We talked about that last night with Dr. Foley. Me going out to, if I go out to Viroqua and get called for a C-section, the last C-section I did was 36 years ago. Not a good move. I know it's an easy procedure. I know it's just you go in and you go in, you go in, and the baby comes out. And then you close, and then you close, and then you close. I know that. But I'm not the person to do that. So what we found out is that the pods have to be big enough to be able to help support each other and cross-cover for each other. And that's why you see 3 surgeons. That's the magic number for us right now is 3. That provides enough cross-coverage so that somebody can have a life, but not too many people so they can have volume. And that's the push and pull of this. So the other regional surgeons are the ones that are the best suited to provide call coverage for each other. For new techniques and for new skills, our regional surgeons will come into the main house and work with our subspecialists. They can work in our surgical skills lab. They'll come and sometimes scrub on some of our cases to do one or two, and then we'll go out and proctor them for specific cases for their first one or two. And so this is a way that the main house can help support the regional surgeon. Communication is key, and this is an area that's shown tremendous growth between record. Thank goodness for Epic. I don't think I heard myself say that. PACS, email, so many different ways now we can communicate. You have to have really good transportation, and you have to be committed to quick transportation back and forth between centers. You've got to provide administrative help for these regional surgeons, so salary and benefits, help them with coding and reimbursement. Don't make them do their patient satisfaction surveys. We hate doing that stuff. Help them do their MOC, and we maintain a department-wide registry of cases that's for all surgeons, La Crosse and our region, and we do quality outcomes for each other to make sure that we maintain quality across the whole system. And don't submit to this volume as a surrogate for quality. You know, it's not all about creating a system so your regional surgeons can send everything to the center. What's important is to educate them to track and know their outcomes so they can do as much of their practice as they possibly can it with high quality in their own hospital. CME opportunities, include them. No excuse now with distance learning and whatnot not to be able to include them. Teaching, I mentioned that we are using our regional surgeons and our previous graduates as well in our teaching program. And our residents love working with these people. Research, we've now got 4 papers that our regional surgeons have headed up. So they actually have a research opportunity in our system. And finally, these are the principles, I think, of rural surgery practice. So how do you make this work? Assist them in their ability to perform appropriate cases locally. It's not just send me your cases. It's let me help you do quality surgery to the best of your ability in your environment. Co-manage difficult cases. That may be all over the phone. It may be over distance learning. It may be occasionally a patient is sent up. Connectivity on every level. Make them feel part of your system. Don't make them feel like second-class citizens. And they have to have a competitive salary and benefits, otherwise that's not going to work. And you have to recognize not just their direct production, but the production that indirectly they provide for your system. If they weren't there, where would those cases go? And where would sort of the penumbra of cases go? So bottom line in our system, over the past 27 years, of the 18 general surgeons who have practiced regionally, we've had only 3 leave our system. And that's pretty good if you look at the rural surgery statistics. 7 of these regional surgeons have practiced in one location for more than 20 years. So a sign, hopefully, that the system isn't too bad. These are the solutions to recruitment. We need to increase medical school enrollment, but also have programs like the WARM program that get people into rural areas. We need some rural rotations and residencies. You have to have mentorship from general surgeons and from rural general surgeons if you expect people to actually go there. There ought to be a central list of residencies that actually have experience with training people for rural general surgery. And right now, there are huge programs in loan forgiveness, scholarships, signing bonuses for people that actually want to go into a rural area. And that's a good thing. Who's the chair of the board right after me? He said the solutions are simple. There's just 3 of them. There they are. Money, money, money. I think that competitive salary benefits are very important. But I think appropriate scope of practice, that's equally important. You have to have an innovative hospital working with you. I think you absolutely have to have a network that you are part of, that you have some relationship with a big network that can help you with some of these challenges. And you've got to have a cooperative call program. there's nobody's going to go into the practice of surgery and be on call 365 days a year anymore. And thank goodness that's true. I tell my grads, if they're going to a rural area where they're the only surgeon, you negotiate that contract so that you've got 4 to 6 weeks of vacation, 2 weeks of CME, at least one day off every week, and you ought to have at least what you got during residency, at least one weekend off every month. And the bargaining chip is you tell the hospital, if I don't come, you have nobody. If I do come, look at all the coverage you do have. Please don't look at the coverage that you're not going to get, the missing time I'm not going to be there. I want to be there for 40 years. With that, I'd like to thank you very much again for the invitation and for your attention, and glad to take some questions if you have them. Thank you.